know who you are. And yet, I have to say that at every opportunity, when service opportunity has been pointed out, they are ready with their hands, with their backs, with their legs, with their wallets. And they do this because of a dedication to serving our people in the name of Jesus Christ. And after the example also of General Vartan Mamigonian. And it was at Camp Arda that I first was educated about our Armenian history of General Vartan Mamigonian. I had heard his name. I knew we were honoring him on Vartanon, Siege February, but the lesson was given at Camp Arda. The Vartanon's celebration or commemoration could be the most important one from an Armenian historical perspective, but also from the genesis of service to our fellow Armenians. The Battle of Avarayar is an amazing event from the perspective of addressing the greatest challenge a person can meet, which is that of laying down your life for your brother. And the history that was recorded by Gevon Yegishe is that the Armenians were outnumbered 10 to 1, 66,000 Armenians and over 600,000 Persian soldiers with heavy elephants. What was the purpose of this war? This battle was, for the Persians, was oppression of this minority group who will not give up their Christian faith and be like us. And the battle for the Armenians was the preservation of their Christian faith, the preservation of their national identity as Armenians, truly a battle for their freedom of conscience. And the historian has written that on the night before battle, knowing what these odds are, knowing that they're very likely to be killed the next day, General Vartan brought them together and with Gevon Yegishe, Gevon Geretz, first gave a speech, followed by communion. And the speech was reiterating that our Christian faith is not like a garment that we might change according to the circumstances. Let us remember, this is in 451. And I can say it today. Our Christian faith is not like a garment that we might change according to the circumstances. It is part and parcel of our bones and blood and personality. If you try to force your will upon us, we are ready to suffer and to be tortured and even die. However, you should know in advance that there is no power on earth which can force us to change our Christian faith. Because our covenant is not with man, but with the Almighty God. Amen. And so with that speech, General Vartan took communion with these soldiers who all knew that they very likely would die the next day, but they also knew that their purpose was given to the last full measure to defend their Christian faith, their freedom of conscience. And I will tell you that if they did not do that, if they didn't give it every effort they could, none of us would be here today calling ourselves Armenians. We would have been completely assimilated more than 1,000 years ago, and Armenians would have been a footnote in the text of history. They lost that battle. They were martyred. General Vartan was martyred. Who survived was his nephew, Vahan Mamigonian. Vahan Mamigonian persisted. Vahan Mamigonian assembled more soldiers and engaged in guerrilla warfare against the Persian government, against the Persian king, for 30 years. 30 years. Until the Persians realized that these Armenians are not going away, they're not going down. They'll give their life for their Christian faith, and they're still coming back. And so was created the Treaty of Nawars in which the Christian, the Armenian Christians were allowed to preserve their ethnic identity, to worship their Christian faith, to worship their Lord, and preserve their way of life. And that is the event, 30 years of persistence, that enabled Armenians to survive as a people and to survive as a Christian people. When I talk about this event of history in the Knights of Vartan, I have said several times that the battle was not the only victory. The persistence was the victory. The persistence against odds that were incalculable. The persistence against the likelihood that every day we go back to the battlefield, every day we're going to lose and we're going to keep fighting until the Lord gives us this victory. And He has instructed us to lay down our lives for our brothers if needed. And that is what gave us the blessing of perpetuating our race. Now I come forward to 2016. And we have here a beautiful church, the Armenian Cilicia Evangelical Church. 94 years. Everyone here, I know, has your own story of the challenges and difficulties that you have encountered over the years, over the generations, to overcome obstacles, overcome objections, overcome difficulties of all sorts, inside ourselves even, among ourselves, and from outsiders. I know, I've been active in church governance, I've been active in church fundraising, just like all of you. I know how difficult it can be. I know how sometimes I'm ready to resign. I'm just ready. I've had enough. And then I think about it. I talk with people I trust. I ask the Lord if what I should do, and the whole discussion is over. I'm going back to the battlefield. And that level of persistence that you all have shown that brought you through 94 years is what we're celebrating tonight. It's not the dial on the clock. It's not the passage of time. It's the persistence that gave you the grace that came from God, the grace to forgive, the grace to keep trying, the grace to give all that you could give because you knew that this is God's will for your life in this church. God bless you for it. That level of persistence is what the Christian life requires, it demands. Persistence. And where does that come from? That comes from persistent faith in our Lord that He will make it possible. Timothy made a great remarks in introducing one of the Psalms that all things are possible to overcome any challenge. I loved it. And I knew that this was going to come up when I gave my remarks. And that is the belief that we have to bring forward every day in order to achieve 94 years of a successful and growing church. The same is true with the Knights of Vartan. I want to share with you what some of that persistence has yielded in this current generation. It's no secret, many of you are well aware, that the organization demographic has aged and the numbers as a result have shrunken. However, I know that the brothers that I work with every day, now in my third year as Grand Commander, I know that there is persistence to do everything possible to accomplish our missions. What are those missions that are so important? Knights of Vartan, I'm very, very proud to say, I am proud that it is for me the place I belong. Beyond my dear wife, my family, beyond my church, the Knights of Vartan is the place where my life energy is best spent. It is the highest and best use of my time. And it will continue to be when I've completed this assignment and will find another role in the Knights of Vartan to continue. Why? Because this is a service organization. And the lesson I learned in 1984 in washing those children's feet the same lesson they learned too, and I'm sure that many of them are serving now. So, the Knights of our time, in September, we had a delegation for the very first time in 100 years. We took a delegation of 31 members from all across the United States, representing 13 lodges, 13 out of 24. So it was a majority. And we went to Yerevan. We had an official reception by the governor, who recognized the work and read a gontag that had been written by His Holiness Karakin II, recognizing at the very highest level over 100 years the services that Knights of our time provided. All of it quietly. Nobody asking for fanfare of any kind. But the government wanted to recognize the organization. They had a big reception and they had many ways of saying thank you. That was the only day there was when we were receiving something. The rest of the week we were there, we went to the town of Gebashin in the Kotai Mars, where the Fuller Center for Housing had been constructing a house with involvement of the family. For one family, Toroyan family. This is a lovely family, seven people in the family. One grandmother, the mother, the father, and four children. The youngest one was 4 years old, oldest one was a young teenager. Beautiful kids. He's working very hard. She's keeping the house with four children to look after with the grandmother. They were living in a box for many years. And yet he had a good job. It just said they didn't have the funds to buy a house completely. They were able to do something. They were able to begin building a house, but they ran out of money. And the Fuller Center for Housing is a partner with the Knights of Vartan. So the Knights of Vartan contributes money so that the Fuller Center loans the money to the family to buy all the materials. And then with craftsmen in the village who volunteer their time, and the family's labor, which is also volunteered, they put up a house. Now last year, I visited that same family in their box. I was heartbroken, honestly. There was no bathroom there. There was no water. And the kids are still just bright faces, you know, can't wait to find out where their next house is going to be. The father and the mother is very hopeful. The mother was tearful and very grateful even before their house was created. This year we went and with a local priest in Yerevan, Father Dajak, who's from Boston, came to bless their home. And this family had struggled, but they had put up a beautiful home. Absolutely beautiful. For the seven of them, there were two bedrooms, a nice living room, there was a bathroom with Western-style plumbing, a kitchen with Western-style appliances, and the mother and the grandmother couldn't wait for the blessing in order to use that kitchen. There were 30 of us there. And they had made a dinner for all of us. In every room there were tables. So we could sit and we could eat. We didn't expect this, honestly. We had plans to go out to lunch afterward. But we stayed. In fact, it might have been that some of the people were talking about where we're going to go for lunch. And the father heard this. And he came to me. And he said, stay here for lunch. So we did, and it was perhaps the most blessed moment of all. Their gratitude was evident. And I thought to myself, you know, this is the kind of impact we want to make. This one family, sure. Well, there's another one this year too, and there may be two next year. And the Daughters of Vartan has the same partnership. In fact, the Grand Matron, Sona Manuelian, in New Jersey, is she with her husband, Commander Leo Manuelian. They are the ones who opened this partnership several years ago. And they were doing it themselves and making it available to anyone who wanted to participate. But my immediate predecessor and myself, we decided that we needed to champion this. It's a great opportunity of service. So we do that. All we do is we give money, but we have to administer it, we have to monitor it, we have to make sure that it gets to where it needs to be. Well, we also are supporting 90 orphans in the Azerbaijan border region of Armenia called Tavush. And there in Tavush, there is a church. It's become somewhat famous because of a dear gentleman named Mr. Stevens from Fresno funded the renovation of this church. Now it's called St. Stephen's in the town of Berg in Tavush. There's a lovely Father Aram there who supervises the care of 90 children. They're all aged, the youngest one is 4. And some of them have one parent, but none of the parents have a livelihood. They're single parents and they can't work. So there's 90 of them that are classified as orphans. Last year, we went to the same church, and at that time we were sponsoring 25. But we've been promoting this sponsorship, and many of the lodges have added more. And we met a young lady who herself was 22 years old last year. And she had with her a little boy who was 4. And she had been married when she was 18, or maybe 17 or 18. Her husband was a soldier for the Armenian army. And he was manning the border when there was an eruption of gunfire. He was involved in the exchange and he was killed. Well, his young wife was pregnant with their first son. So she had the baby and she named this young boy David after her husband. And there, Father Aram introduced us. He told me the story of this young lady, and we met young David, who was 4 years old at the time. He is being cared for through the Children of Armenia sponsorship program under the Knights of Vartan sponsorship. We are contributing merely $250 a year for his care, medical care, for education, and for housing in the church facility. There are now 90 like that, 90 children. We went back this year, young David was 5. We met him again. The Lieutenant Grand Commander of the Knights of Vartan, Mr. Hunan Arshakyan, is a younger man, and he has a young son, aged 5, whose name is David. And Hunan's a pretty tough guy. He's almost as tall as our MC here. And he's a pretty tough guy, but he was tearful when he met this young boy, Tavush, because he realized this boy is like my son David, same age, and he's not going to have the same opportunity. We're going to do everything we can to help him. So this motivated more support, and that's one of the reasons why we now have 90. A large part of this added support came from the lodge in Boston, who had a big fundraiser earlier this year for this purpose. And the last example I'll give you is the support of Armenian schools who have been damaged by earthquake or damaged by a lack of maintenance over many years. We visited this time the Knights of Vartan School. It's a school that serves from kindergarten up through 9th grade. And this school has been named after the Knights of Vartan because the Knights have been major contributors to everything there, to renovation of buildings, to school supplies, to budget. I was quite taken aback when I arrived there. I was asked to greet the children in the schoolyard, which was a yard maybe about as big as this hall. And there were, I think, about 600 children out there. Lined up, just think. And they were lined up in military formation. So I greeted them and they responded in unison with a salute, welcome the Grand Commander. And after that I met the President and our tour went inside. We saw that they've been updating their buildings. They have some classrooms that are state of the art. Their academic accomplishments are state of the art on Western standards. They are able to raise, educate children who will compete in the global economy in 10 years. And this, in part, is the work of the Knights of Vartan. Well, there are many other examples I can give you. And some of them are more personal. Some of them involve more than